comes to Cape Town, we have that belief that many of our forefathers, were Oliya. How do we verify that? How could we verify that their particular type of sainthood?
Well, the truth of the matter is, let me just give you a theory that I have about this entire affair. Yes, we believe in awliya. We believe in men who are on the level as we've indicated and described a few moments ago. And we also believe solidly from the Quran and the Sunnah that karamat or miraculous or supernatural events sometimes occur around these the individuals, where they go, when they make dua, when they touch people and so on. That is also firmly established in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet. So we have all of those beliefs, theoretically. But now if you ask me, are the people that we refer to as awliya in Cape Town, are they awliya? Or not? Now that, of course, is very difficult historically to verify. Because a wali is a person who does not claim he's a Nabi, but he's clearly of the pious people, salih. He prays regularly, he makes dhikr regularly, you can see the salah and the piety hang over his face and his entire demeanor and his body.
Yes.
His piety, like they say, a tree starts bending over, the more fruit it gets.
Mm-hmm.
Like the awliya, salih and the ulama. The more knowledge they gain, the more humble they become. You can see it clearly in the person's demeanor, in the way he walks, in the way he sits. For us to verify from that angle is virtually impossible. Because all of these people we have here are historical figures.
Yeah.
They lived, some of them lived 300 years ago, like Tong Yusuf, Mathla. Mm-hmm. So we need to understand that in Cape Town we have a slightly different concept of a wali. The people we refer to as awliya might have been technically awliya, because it is also the point of view, and this is debatable,
mm-hmm.
especially the Salafiyya, they have a problem with the idea that the miracles of the awliya not only occurs during their lifetime, but some of the scholars say it must happen after the death, else they weren't genuine ones.
Yeah.
It has to happen after the death. And that's exactly what Ibn Taymiyyah is referring to. And he described Musa al-Kadhim, the qabr of Musa al-Kadhim in Iraq, as being tiryaq al-mujarrab. Quite clear what this meaning. There are clear miracles happening around the Qabr. In the vicinity, not in my house, not in the Haram, not in India, not in Sydney, exactly on the spot where the Qabr is. So, it appears that he accepts this view as well. That karamat, or the supernatural deeds which Allah causes to happen as a proof, as an honor, as a proof and an indication, that person is not an average Muslim, is an accepted a believer and slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That happens at the place where they are.
Yes.
That's the view of the majority of the Ash'ari. And indeed, even the Salafiyya has been debasing to indicate. So, did that happen in Cape Town? Lots of stories, in fact, indeed, has been told, and maybe people like yourself and scholars of history and so on used to make research and verify whether this happened in and around these tombs. Were they miraculous deeds? In fact, we were told that even non-Muslims saw things happening. Masala in this particular grave up here, and then on the basis of what they said, the Muslims, when they built the Qabr. That's one aspect of what we have in Cape Town. The other aspect is very important. There seems to be a convergence of history and of religion, of religious ideas and beliefs, and what happened historically. All the people that we talk about, if we go to the Qabr of Mathlan, Tong Yusuf, the first thing you are told, he was an exile, a political prisoner. He fought against the Dutch.
Yes.
If we go to the Qabr in Muizenberg, on the corner of Muizenberg, the Qabr is hidden away behind the field there, I think,
yes,
church or so. If we go there, he was a political exile. He was a slave. If you ask the historians like Dr. Ahmad, I don't know if you met Dr. Ahmad David. Yeah, we used to host the program.
Yes. I never met him, but I read his book. Yes.
And he said, he was authority, and he said most of these people were slaves who ran away. So our association and our admiration for these people are not only a religious matter. It's also political. It's historical. It's our heritage. So a Salafi or someone who criticizes us, he needs to understand this not one-sided. And from this angle, all of these people would be regarded as awliya. And I'm referring it to a concept which joins two things, history and religion. Likely they were people of enormous piety, at least from use of this evidence from the writings, that he was a man of enormous piety, immense insight. I would personally call him an arif billah. The knowledge and the insight into Tawheed was enormous, as you see from the writings. So he's likely he was of that particular level. But from another angle, we admire and we look up to these maqabir and we look after these maqabir also because they were historically slaves.
Mm-hmm.
It's part of our sense of liberation, so part of our sense of fighting against oppression and injustice. So I think that's very important to hold both these ideas in mind when it comes to Hebrew in particular.
Yes.
Not only a religious matter, it's also a historical matter. I'm not entirely sure if this is the case in other parts of the world, but yeah, definitely. They seem to be a unique idea or concept of the world.